Now, when we want to figure out the population of a system, not at the limiting cases of very low or very high densities, but at intermediate densities, and figure out the intensity, then we have to solve the rate equation system. We saw this earlier with all the terms involved. And we have to compute the specific intent, the energy density of the radiation, because this enters the strength of all the stimulated transition coefficients. In addition, we then can compute the observable intensities from an interstellar cloud, which is formulated as a specific intensity. So in units of energy per second, per area, per frequency interval, so per hertz, and per direction, so from a certain directional angle, given here in steradian. And the specific intensity change along a certain path through the medium from S to S plus dS can be written as here the change over the small path length dS of the specific intensity at frequency nu in a certain direction, n, vector n, is given by the reduction of the intensity described by an absorption coefficient, kappa, in this direction, that is applied to the intensity, plus an emission coefficient, epsilon, in this direction. So we have along this path length absorption of intensity that reduces the intensity, and we have emission of photons along this path length that increases the intensity. In the general case, the intensities are modified by the square of the refractive index, which in a plasma, so n nu in a plasma is given as 1 over omega p squared, so the plasma frequency. And the plasma frequency is given by the number of electrons charge squared epsilon naught, the electron mass. So for 10 electrons per cubic centimeter, we have a plasma frequency smaller than 1 hertz, which means that our refractive index in the radio regime approaches 1. So we can ignore that here. But to compute how the radiation changes along this line S through a medium, we need the emission and the absorption coefficient along this path, and we can compute those from our balance equations, because the emission, of course, depends on the population of the upper level. So we have h nu ij ni a ij, so I is the upper level, times a profile function, which I will explain in a second. So what we have here is, this is the number of transitions. A is the probability for a transition to occur in one system. Ni is the number of populated systems. So the product of the two is the expectation value, so to speak. So and so many transitions will take place. This is the number of photons that are emitted. This is the energy of the photon. So h nu times n times a is the total energy that is emitted. And the phi, the line profile function, is describing how the various photons are distributed around the line center frequency and how they are distributed in the different directions. So this whole thing is divided over 4 pi because photons are emitted in all directions, and 4 pi is the full steradian, the full solid angle. The absorption coefficient, well, let's use a different kappa nu, is also easily expressed in our Einstein coefficient. So it's the energy of the photon times the difference between all absorbed photons and all emitted photons. This is the term in the parenthesis. So that's the net remaining number of photons that are being produced or destroyed, and also times the line profile function divided by C. Okay, so the line profile function is given by the integral here of this delta function of nu minus nu ij, this should be a nu here, times 1 plus velocity times n vector over c. This here is the Doppler term. So how the projection of the velocity onto the direction of emission or absorption changes the velocity, the frequency of the photon, times the probability distribution of the velocity, and integrating over all three spatial dimensions, the velocity vector here. And this can be approximately written as 1 over 2 pi sigma square root times c over the frequency nu ij times the exponential factor of the profile where we have here the change of the frequency or the difference of the frequency to the line center frequency squared. And the sigma gives the width of the velocity distribution of the Maxwell distribution. We can also, when we look at these terms, we see that epsilon is expressed in terms of R, kappa is expressed in terms of B, but we know that the B can be also expressed in the Einstein A coefficient, so we can also express the epsilon in terms of the kappa times what we call S, the source function. So kappa nu n nu times die Planck Function at a certain frequency nu ij for a certain excitation temperature for the level per ij. Because the certain population ratio ni over nj can be described exactly in the excitation temperature, and then this system will emit according to the Planck function for this excitation temperature. So this is the Kirchhoff's law. And which means we can rephrase our radiative transfer equation. So this is the radiative transfer equation. We can rephrase this in terms of our source function as nu, which is the ratio between the emission and the absorption coefficient, e nu over kappa nu. Which is the Planck function for the excitation temperature, ij. And when we multiply the kappa with the path length s along our line of sight, we can write this as a change of the optical depth tau, so that we can change our differential equation, which was changing over the s. So we had the change of the intensity along the path was described as kappa minus kappa times e I nu plus the epsilon. We can write this and change the integration or the differencing variable. So we look at how the I nu changes with respect to changes in the optical depth tau, and this is given by the source function minus the intensity. So this is a very nice formulation for the radiative transfer equation, because what it basically states is, when we have a small volume element of width d tau, or correspondingly ds, then with this d tau, what happens to the radiation is that we have the radiation e nu entering this box, and in this volume element we will have the source function, so we will have the emission, and we will have an absorption of the radiation. So the change of the initial intensity will be described just by the initial intensity and the local source function. So the formal solution to this system can be written down analytically, just by separation of variables. And we have e to the minus tau, and then times the integral over tau of s tau e to the tau d tau plus the background intensity. Now, even though it is very simple to formally solve the radiative transfer equation, and write the solution here in this in terms of this integral over the source function. However, the source function here depends on the emission and the absorption coefficients, and the emission and absorption coefficients depends on all the populations of the energy levels at all positions. However, they depend on the A and B factors at all positions, and they are also a function and on the local radiation fields. But the local radiation field is actually what we want to compute here in this integral. So there are different approaches to solve this this problem for practical purposes. The first is that we assume a constant source function. And when we do so, we can just analytically integrate our system and can write down the difference between the emitted intensity and the background intensity is S minus E background times 1 minus E to the minus tau. So this term here describes the difference between everything that is emitted in the volume and everything that is absorbed in the volume. In the optical thin case, so optical thin means that the medium is basically transparent to the radiation. We have a very small optical depth. So 1 minus e to the minus tau approach tau, and we have as solution of the right hand side S minus the background intensity times the optical depth. We can normalize this by the emissivity, by the column and the velocity channels, so that we have here this term to have a nice normalization. And we can also now change the energy units by applying the Rayleigh-Jeans approximation and move on to a what is called brightness temperature, where we express the intensity in terms of temperatures. And this is possible because the Rayleigh-Jeans approximation states that the intensity of a black body under the Rayleigh-Jeans limit is expressed here by this prefactor times the temperature of the medium. So the intensity is directly proportional to the temperature. And this means we can express an intensity or an intensity difference here as brightness temperature by multiplying with this factor c squared over 2k and the velocity and the frequency squared. So we can express the intensity in units that are given in Kelvin, and we can also reformulate the Doppler frequency interval by converting it to the Doppler velocity interval, so that delta v, delta velocity equals c over the frequency times delta of the frequency. So we get as a new unit for the specific emissivity per column, Kelvin kilometer per second meter squared. we can again look at our three limiting cases and look at the resulting emissivity. We saw that for the LTE case, we have a Boltzmann distribution of the level populations I and J. That is just given here by the Boltzmann factor and the ratio of the statistical weights. We saw that the excitation temperature then is equal to the kinetic temperature. And we saw also earlier that the source function is the Planck function with the excitation temperature as argument. So consequently, the source function is just the black body emission of our medium. It depends on the kinetic temperature. So we can write down an analytic expression for the specific emissivity and integrate over the line profile. The simplest case would be a two-level system, for example the C+, where we have the two levels 2P1/2 and 2P3/2. And on the right-hand side, we see the LTE emissivity as a function of the temperature. And you see that this is a monotonous function with the temperature. And that we have an approximately constant temperature above the energy of the energy above the energy of the energy level difference that corresponds to 91.2 Kelvin for C+. So we are approximately here. And above this temperature, the emissivity turns into a constant function approximately. Which means anything that is a C plus gas hotter than 90 or 100 Kelvin will produce a constant number of photons per volume. And higher temperatures don't lead to an increase in intensity anymore. For a three-level system, this is somewhat more complicated. For the upper transition, here this one, we have a similar behavior. So above something like 60 Kelvin, 60 few Kelvin, I think, is the energy for the upper transition. This is constant, and we have something like 30 Kelvin, 30-something Kelvin for the lower transition. But since this is a three-level system, we can have here this slight overshooting behavior before the emissivity becomes more or less constant. So this is the overshooting in the ground state line. Because in our three-level system, this population can become overpopulated with respect to LTE because we populate from the lower and the upper state and cannot depopulate fast enough. The next step was that we have basically no radiative excitations. That was the next case. And then we have for a two-level system an analytic expression given for the levels. So G upper over G lower times the Boltzmann factor, so the energy H nu over KT times the ratio of CUL over CUL plus AUL. So we have the populating transitions here and the depopulating here. Again, this is CUL times the Boltzmann factor times the ratio is CLU. This can also be written for a three-level system, but the terms then become somewhat more complex because we have now all possible transitions in the term. And we do not show this here, but this is also a nice exercise to write this down. So you do this by setting up the rate equation, ignoring all the B terms, just having the A and the C terms remaining, and then solve this for all the N's. When we look again at the emissivities in the optical thin case and write this now down here, plot this logarithmically, what you see is that below the critical density, so this is the C plus emissivity, so previously we plotted this as a function of the temperature. Now we plot this for two different temperatures as a function of the density, and the critical density for C plus and collisions with H2 was in the order of 10 to the 3, and for electrons in the order of somewhere between 1 and 10 depending on the temperature. And you see that the emission, we call the regime for temperature, for densities below the critical density, subthermal, because thermal excitation corresponds to pure collisional dominated. In the subthermal case, and here this is then LTE. In the subthermal case, we observe a linear behavior here in this log-log plot. So when we go down by a factor of 10 in intensity, we have also a factor of about 10 lower emissivity. So we have a linear increase in the log plot of the emissivity with density, which means in the low density case, the intensity is also is sensitive to the density. Above the critical density, it becomes insensitive to the density and remains constant. So adding additional collisional partners doesn't lead to a higher number of emitted photons anymore, because we also increase the number of de-exciting collisions. So we cannot produce more photons just by putting in more collision numbers, a collision partner. This is again for the atomic carbon, the emissivity as a function of density. Here we have the same behavior. You see the subthermal behavior here and this somewhat non-monotonic behavior for the ground state transition. You see that this happens here at lower densities already and at lower temperatures. So we have here 20 and 200 Kelvin, while for the C+, we have hundreds and thousands of Kelvin.